Suicide prevention isn't just at the moment when someone is in crisis, although that is also an important moment in time for many people, but it's about what can we be doing to create healthy communities where we can talk about these things. That's why I love your podcast so much.
I'm Lily Cornell Silver, and welcome to Mind Wide Open, my mental health focus interview series. Today, I am talking to Dr. Christine Yu Moutier, who is the Chief Medical Officer at the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. And today, we're going to be talking about what to do when you or someone you know is in crisis, the stigma that exists around suicide and how it's currently being shed, and what mental health and suicide look like in marginalized communities. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you enjoy.
Hello, Dr. Moutier. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thanks so much for having me, Lily. I love your podcast and everything that you're all about related to mental health. It is so awesome and so powerful.
Well, thank you so much. I mean, that means the world coming from you, especially. But thank you. No, I truly appreciate you being here so much, especially it's my second to last episode of Mind Wide Open. And so it feels very synchronous to have you here. I'm in Zoom class language, synchronous, asynchronous. It feels very serendipitous to have you here. And I would just love to talk to you about your experience as Chief Medical Officer at the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. I mean, like what, I can't think of a more perfect guest to be talking to you right now. I would love to start just by talking about the specific focus on suicide prevention, because suicide is something that I've talked about a lot on the series. Obviously, I have personal connection to it through friends and family. And one of the main things that I've noticed, besides suicide being one of the more highly stigmatized things within the mental health umbrella, that there can be so much more focus kind of societally put on repairing in the aftermath versus prevention beforehand. So I'm wondering if you could speak to that dichotomy and why the emphasis is on prevention.
I mean, there's so much to say there. What I want to say is that the topic of suicide is obviously super serious and very intense, both on all sides of it. If you've lived through the experience of suicide loss, if you struggled yourself, if a loved one has struggled and been suicidal, stigma is going down. And so now there are so many things that the science tells us that we can be doing, what we call upstream from suicide risk, mm-hmm. meaning mm-hmm. suicide prevention isn't just at the moment when someone is in crisis, although that is also an important moment in time for many people, but it's about what can we be doing to create healthy communities where we can talk about these things. That's why I love your podcast so much, that if when you take stigma out, we get to actually talk about the experiences that we're having and be, strengthened by each other, learn more about how you can interpret different experiences, symptoms, and signs. Sometimes there are just like these very individual signs that our body or our brains might signal to us that we didn't even know until we start really reflecting and almost like looking at ourselves like scientists, that can be ways that we know it's time to engage in various self-care activities or to plug back into treatment or to share that with certain important people in your life, family members, trusted mentors or therapists, mental health professionals. So, I mean, suicide is a leading cause of death. We know that it's a health-related outcome, and that means that it's genetics, it's biology, but it's also our early life, our current life, and there are things we can do about that. So we really do take a very, very broad approach at AFSP. It's science-based, but prevention means a whole lot of things that we can be doing in the schools and workplaces and families, not just when you get to the doctor or with a therapist.
Right. And where do you think that stigma comes from and why is it lightening right now? Because I agree. I mean, just based on doing the series, that's what I've heard from multiple mental health professionals, is that the stigma is kind of being shed. But where do you think that comes from?
You know, I've had to think about this so much because the culture is changing so quickly in a positive way around both mental health and suicide. The way I look at it is if you think about other stigmatized topics that, let's say, even like cancer, certainly HIV, AIDS, when you think about what changes a culture's view and their hearts and their minds and their attitudes about it. It oftentimes starts with science, certainly when it's a health related issue, right. But even non-health related issues. And so knowledge is power. And when you look at the history of the science around suicide risk and prevention, it's a pretty young field. And so I feel like in our suicide prevention research field and that translation out into the kind of into the world, that is happening, but we're still at a relatively early point in time in the kind of whole development of that field.
When you specify, you know, that suicide prevention comes in the medical and psychology fields, but also needs to be infused in like the workplace and school. That's something that I've talked about on this series. I've spoken about losing a close friend to suicide in high school and how much emphasis was placed on almost like kind of a PR cleanup versus like actual care. And then also I was close with many teachers at the school that we were at, and they, most of them said like, we didn't have training necessarily. Like we didn't have the training that we needed both to spot the signs beforehand and then also to help our students in the aftermath. So how do you think, you know, from a professional standpoint, what would that look like? What would suicide prevention and suicide destigmatization look like in the workplace and look like in schools?
Yeah, I love this because you can really actually even start with like very early childhood experiences in kindergarten and in first grade. And what that can look like is not just building in what is happening now across many states. They're required now to implement social emotional learning curricula into schools. And that is awesome because that is a way to teach all of us about how we tick and what emotions mean and what they might signal us to be more proactive in our lives. But there are other things that can happen, which are educating teachers, parents, and also building in a culture. And this is a harder thing to do, but through leadership, policy, education, and there are even like, there's a study of something called the good behavior game, which is a classroom management system for kindergartners and first graders that helps not just reward good behavior, but actually develops a whole wraparound way in the cultural environment of the classroom for kids to learn, you know, kind of how to manage their own emotions and behavior. And that program was studied in urban Baltimore, and those kids then 15 years later had very different outcomes in terms of rates of graduation, their academic record, but also mental health experiences, suicidal thoughts, substance use, trouble with the law. So it could ideally look like building something that is both building kind of more optimal personal development and, you know, the word coping can sound so pejorative, but really like learning how you tick and making choices for yourself at learning that along the way. I mean, that's sort of like the utopian view, but we're so far from that. Like we still have so much stigma around even just feelings and emotions that people are worried about who it's safe to share that with. That's how kind of early we are in our process of building that into schools and workplaces and health systems.
And it's so interesting that you bring up, I mean, even starting in kindergarten, because I think there's this idea that like there is an age that's too young to be dealing with social emotional learning, but specifically like intense and big emotions and especially suicidal emotions. Like there's this idea that it's too young. Even the school that I went to was 6 through 12 and I was in 10th grade, but there was this idea that like, oh, the sixth graders are too young to be subjected to this. Like we can't be having conversations with them around it, but that almost seemed to be more damaging.
Right. I mean, it's such a tricky thing because where that is coming from is the concern about contagion, which suicide contagion is a real phenomenon, but I think it almost got misinterpreted to say, we can't talk about, you know, I think people actually get confused. Like, can I ask somebody if they're having suicidal thoughts or will that be dangerous? Like those are very, very different conversations. And it's so important if you're worried about somebody to open up that supportive, safe dialogue where you absolutely can and should ask if they're having thoughts of ending their life. That is not That is a separate thing from contagion, which is when the topic is sensationalized, glorified, made to look like it's a real solution, or it's so graphically portrayed, let's say, in entertainment, that it draws people who are struggling closer to their suicidal urge. So I almost feel like in the school setting, there has been a lot of conservative kind of approaches that maybe we shouldn't do direct, like, topic of suicide in their face until a certain age. And there is some rationale to that. But I think the main point is that most school districts are pretty early in their journey of figuring out how to implement and how to make it a priority. I mean, teachers are stretched a million different ways, but that doesn't mean this doesn't warrant, you know, a high priority for them to get that learning.
Right. And you mentioned too, because we're in kind of the early stages of shedding the stigma, it being difficult to know both what to do if you worry that someone's struggling or what to do when you yourself is struggling. And that's also something I've talked about in the series, is my own experiences with suicidal ideation. And even though I had access to any resource that I may have needed, and I had access to a mom who was totally understanding and very supportive, I held a lot of fear and uncertainty about, like, what do I do if I'm feeling this way? Because I didn't know that if I told my therapist that I'm experiencing, like, suicidal ideation, am I going to get locked in a padded room? You know, like, and it was just an interesting thing for me to experience, because I come from a family situation and a home situation where there wasn't a lot of stigma just in my own circle, but I still felt so much fear and uncertainty around being honest about my feelings. So I'm wondering if there's anyone watching this show who has similar feelings, or, you know, a loved one of theirs has similar feelings, what do you recommend to do? Like, what does it look like when you experience suicidal ideation or suicidal thoughts? What should you do?
Well, I'm so glad you're bringing this up, Lily, because it's a terrific point you're making, which is that even when you're the most, like, knowledgeable, educated, you don't have stigma, you encourage other people to talk about it. But when you're the one in distress, I think it's a very primitive instinct built into basically all of animal species that when you feel vulnerable, there's an automatic, like, pulling back and almost like putting up the shell, like the roly-poly bug.
Right. Especially when you don't know what the reaction is going to be. You don't know what's going to happen.
Exactly. Add it being that you never learned about this, that it wasn't necessarily a topic for discussion. And as you're saying, even if it was, and you're in an environment where that is a normal topic around the dinner table, which is the ideal way mental health should be. Even in that circumstance, when you're the one in distress, you feel that sense of pulling back, of fear, shame, what is safe? Like, the brain is a physical organ in the body. So in that moment, it is not functioning at its best. And so it's not giving you the clearest pathway in terms of, like, problem solving and what to do, who to talk to. So I would just say to that person that there are safe people in your life. Because we all have them. Sometimes we don't know who they are yet. And so what will happen, I think, is sometimes people who are in distress will kind of test the waters, and they'll, like, put little feelers out. So if you're on the receiving end, if you're a friend or a parent or a teacher, and somebody is saying things like, I'm just feeling a little bit overwhelmed these days. I don't know how much more I can take. I mean, that's a little more obvious, but anything that's like, kind of like, basically a hinting at what might be a much deeper level of just feeling desperate and unsure underneath the surface, that is something to hone in on and to say, you know, maybe if now's not the time, definitely not a hallway conversation at school or in the workplace, but, like, can we talk and check in? Because I want to make sure that I'm hearing you and I'm understanding where you are. That is your whole purpose in opening up that dialogue. You don't need to solve problems, because that's not what it's about. It's about you showing loving curiosity to understand what they're going through, because that means something and carries a lot of therapeutic value in and of itself.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that answer. Because, I mean, as I said, even someone who has access to whatever resources I would need, like, because we're so early in these stages of talking about suicide and suicide prevention openly, it's like, what are you supposed to do? You know, there is so, and especially as you said, when you're in that state, even if you have all the tools, you know, there's very little logic and rationale available to you in your own mind.
Yes. And, you know, I think if you're the one in distress and you're not sure what to do, let's say you've identified one person in your life who's probably trustworthy and safe, I would actually try to set them up for their best response by saying, I want to talk to you about something that I've been going through or that I'm experiencing. It's really private and I'm kind of taking a risk, like connecting with you on it. And I don't need you to solve this for me. What I need you to do is to hear me and give me support and unconditional love. And maybe there will be ways and next steps forward. But what I'm really looking for in this conversation is your being present with me and being able to handle it and hear it. Right. I just think, you know, so many people, it's a foreign experience. It's not something they've necessarily had to do a lot of. And so they start to, their anxiety rises. Yeah. So like help them out by giving them a little bit of like framing maybe.
Right. And something that's been important for me in my own interpersonal relationships, you know, especially with my mom, is specifying what support looks like if you can. So in times when I'm not in crisis, being able to say like, when I am feeling in crisis or feeling like I need support, this is what support looks like for me, because that can be totally different for everybody.
Oh, and that is a really amazing thing that's a sign of sophistication in your own journey and in your relationship with your mom, to give your loved one that gift to say, here's what support would look like in that moment. Sometimes you have to figure it out for yourself, right?
You don't know
what that is, but the minute you start and like, even just maybe through a conversation, sometimes it helps figure that out as well. But I think that's what I hope that many, many people, and being inspired by you and your podcast and our work at AFSP, you know, we have chapters across all 50 states and they are having these dialogues with each other and like peer to peer teaching each other exactly how it works for them. You know, so our programs, we have programs that are education for the loved ones of someone who either has had a suicide attempt or is struggling. And if you're interested in those, any of your listeners, go to afsp.org and you can find your local chapter and tap into any of these programs. But those programs are an educational experience and a tool. And then I think what can happen is your learning journey really starts when you start opening up that dialogue with trusted people in your life.
You know, really like any conversation, it's intersectional. It's an intersectional issue. And I'm wondering if you could speak to the experience of suicidal ideation and suicidal stigma, even within marginalized communities.
Probably no matter what family or culture you grew up in, there's going to be stigma and opportunities for growth and learning. But what we're seeing in the data, especially during the pandemic, is that the national U.S. number of suicides during 2020 actually went down from 2019 to 2020 year over year. It was amazing, by 5.6%. That's actually a decent amount for suicide numbers. But in the states where they've actually taken the time now to analyze their data a little bit further, for example, in the state of Connecticut and Massachusetts, we see that non-white, so Black and other communities of color, their rate of suicide went up, in some cases doubling during 2020, mm-hmm. And during the pandemic, compared to the white residents of those states where rates went down. And so advocating for policies where we increase our workforce to be representative of the actual population, where there is a requirement for training in cultural competency, so that there's a better likelihood that when you, as whatever background you're from, encounter that health professional, and you may give it one shot because you're not sure how it's going to go in terms of even expressing your internal experiences to a health provider, whether it's a primary care doctor or a mental health professional, so that there's a greater likelihood that they will be listening with an educated ear that doesn't just make those racially biased assumptions. There's tremendous research that shows that when a person of color steps into a doctor's office with the same symptoms, let's say of heart disease or any kind of physical or mental illness, that they're less likely to receive the correct diagnosis and a full important treatment plan. So there is just a lot of work to do that relates to structural racism, as well as very specific changes that need to be made within the field so that the workforce is educated and connecting with real people with real needs.
Thank you so much for speaking to that. I think it's something that has been left out of the forefront of the mental health conversation for a long time. And so to have a professional speak to it is so important. And I'm wondering if you would feel comfortable speaking to your own experience around mental health. And, you know, a lot of people, especially the people that I've had on my show, are involved in mental health advocacy or involved in psychology or whatever it may be because of their own personal experiences. So I'm wondering what that looks like for you.
What happened for me was that during medical school was my first experience when I had major mental health symptoms. I was anxious, crawling out of my skin, fear of failure. And I hadn't allowed myself, and maybe I grew up in a family, I'm half Asian. So that was, cultural factors were a big part. Like, you know, I'm the firstborn in a Chinese father family. So you're always the best. There's no question about it. And asking for help is sort of like a foreign language. And so what happened for me was a very massive crisis that in a way I look back on, and it sounds weird, but like, fortunately, I had to actually take a break and get help. And that year off was transformational because I got therapy for the first time. And so then once I developed like a PTSD to the medical environment because I was just so ill when I had left. So coming back in was like a big deal. And then once you've experienced that, that amount of suffering and also getting help and realizing that this is a whole world of reality, you kind of become sensitized to the cultural environment. In my case, in academic medicine, where there wasn't not a language for it, but like you dare not talk about those real experiences. So, I was in it by then. I finished medical school residency training. By the time I was chief resident, I had probably given off a vibe or maybe was talking a little bit about my experience enough so that anyone who was gravitating towards that topic was sharing with me, was getting, advice. And I started learning that these are human issues. It does not cut across, like, doctors are not protected from this. We are human too. And then later, by the time, fast forward a few years later, I was a dean in the medical school that I had struggled in, which was a wild kind of full circle experience. There were a number of physicians who died by suicide. And this was at University of California, San Diego School of Medicine. Mm-hmm. And like more than a dozen over a period of 15 years. And so I got put in charge of doing something about it, in my boss's words, and had the experience of really like figuring out what constitutes effective suicide prevention. Forget about, like, I'm not my colleagues or my students' doctor, but just in a community, in a school environment that happened to be a medical school. And I also, my family has some genetic loading for mental illness. So it's very much a lived experience on a number of different fronts for me. Sometimes I wish it weren't quite so lived in an ongoing way. But it certainly has opened up my mind to the fact that there is a science that's growing, that is shedding light, but so much of the world is still, the light has not been fully illuminating things. There's still so much darkness and so much work to do. And I think that's the beauty of an organization that I'm fortunate to work for as chief medical officer at the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, because these are tens of thousands of people across all 50 states who have all been personally touched, like you, Lily, and are speaking out and realizing that there's so much that can be done education-wise, community strengthening-wise, safety, building that safety net, and importantly, again, advocacy and policy-wise.
That I think it's so important to you sharing your experience coming from a family where mental health wasn't necessarily talked about, to having to kind of inundate yourself really intensely in that experience, not only through your own struggles, but through being in the field professionally. And I'm wondering also what your experience has looked like, especially in this last year as an Asian American woman, and what your mental health has been and how you've been taking care of yourself.
Walking my own personal journey of kind of self-care and learning about how I tick and how to prevent crisis and kind of keep my own resilience reservoir full for so long, since, 30 years ago when I had that first crisis. If I'm looking ahead and I see that I have a super stressful several weeks coming up, I will actually make some changes to what time I'm going to bed, what I'm putting into my body, how I alert like my spouse and my family members, like, hey, this is coming. I'm going to try my best not to put that on you, but just give me a little extra compassion. And I think even just like having that mindset, almost like you give yourself a reset a little bit, and you're just kind of like more ready for it in a way. It's weird, but probably lots of, years of therapy and like little tools along the way just sort of get built in a little bit more innately.
What is something that is giving you hope right now?
Oh gosh, I think I feel the most hope around what I feel like is a tipping point that's happening in the world around mental health. And I mean, I've been feeling it for some time, but then during the pandemic, oh my goodness. I mean, like in a way, who wasn't struggling with something because of what it did to all of our lives? But what that's done, sort of like the unanticipated or unintended consequence, is people are talking about it so much more. And I think normalizing that dialogue, especially for people like us with lived experience or loss, it's almost like, whoa, the world suddenly is like speaking our language. And maybe it opens up new opportunities to take the next step, to be authentic, to take a risk, to step out and try something new, maybe to get treatment for the first time. That's definitely been happening during the pandemic, where rates of help seeking and accessing mental health services are like higher than ever before. Mm-hmm. So, I think there is so much reason to hope about the culture changing around this topic and around suicide prevention. I think that's what is the most kind of exciting for me.
Thank you so much for being here. It's been such a pleasure to talk with you.
Oh, thank you so, so much, Lily, for having me on and for doing what you do. And I just really wish you all the best. I know you're going to keep on shining that light.
Thank you.
If you like this episode, please subscribe in Apple Podcasts or Spotify and leave us a review.